A section, somebody please tell me whether it is visible. Okay, B section,
Yes,
somebody tell
ma'am.
me. B section.
Not visible, ma'am.
Okay. Now, one second. Now,
Visible.
correct. Okay, fine. For both, it is visible now. See, today till where I do, right? It is there. Okay, for the internals. Internal question paper pattern is same like previous one. Part A, 8 marks, 3 questions. You have to answer 2. Part B, 7 mark, 3 questions. You have to answer 2. Okay. So in the on the process of studying different protocols, if anything is wrong, please unmute and tell me. Okay. Process of studying the protocols. Next one in the line is a schedule-based protocol. Now, actually, see, each protocol is concentrating on some issue or the other. Okay, maybe something is energy, it is something is time. Okay, all those things. Okay, so here actually it is addressing the idle listening avoidance. So idle listening. Okay, so since the nodes are just because the nodes are placed in the neighborhood, it has to listen to the unwanted signal. So that is actually called idle listening, which is not required for the node. So you need to minimize that, because listening is not a, you can't let it go, because while listening you are wasting the energy of the node. So you need to consider that issue also. So this protocol, okay, schedule-based protocol, addresses that issue. So how actually it addresses the issue? So it employs the TDMA scheme. TDMA scheme is a time division multiplexing axis. It is very simple. So now actually TDMA is I being the like what you call the main controller, I am allocating the time slot. A1 batch, okay, some time, 10 minutes. A2 batch, 10 minutes, next 10 minutes. A3 batch, next 10 minutes. So that time, everyone are clear about their timings. So A1 will be alert, only A1 nodes will be alert only during the first 10 minutes. Afterwards, it will go to sleep mode. Okay, they are free. A2 will be alert only for the second time schedule, time slot. Okay, that is a scheduled one for them. Later, it can go to sleep mode. So in this way, efficiently, we can use the nodes, energy of the nodes. Okay, whenever it has. So A1 people have to communicate to me, okay, only during that first 10 minutes only. Later, they cannot speak. If at all they have to speak something, they have to wait for the second turn. The time slot continues throughout, so they have to wait for their second turn. So when the second turn comes, again for 10 minutes, they can communicate to me. Then again after 10 minutes, they'll go to sleep. So this is actually TDMA scheme. TDMA scheme is used in almost all the communication protocols, if you see. Because that is a basic one to segregate or to minimize these problems and all. So in that actually here if you see the good one is in that actually 3 parts are there. I'll tell you. The setup and maintenance of a schedule involves signaling traffic, especially when faced to variable topologies. So that one, like it is like coordinating, right? So coordinating signals need to be introduced. That anything when we do, some signal have to be introduced. So here also that signaling traffic will be introduced. So for that little bit of hardware complexity increases. Okay. So if a TDMA variant is employed, time is divided into comparably small slots, and both transmitter and receiver have to agree to slot boundaries. Okay, maintaining time synchronization involves some extra signaling traffic. So when extra signaling comes, automatically we have to think that extra hardware is involved in it. Okay, so among that schedule-based protocol, the first one is the Leech protocol. Okay, low energy adaptive clustering hierarchy. Okay, so now actually I told you what is schedule-based using TDMA. Now in the Leech protocol, the main this thing is highlighting point is it will have clusters. Okay, as I said, A1 batch. A1 batch means maybe some eight students are there in A1 batch. Eight students or seven students are there in A2 batch. Okay, like that, making the batches, so making the clusters. Then we'll have cluster head. Okay, we'll have cluster head. So, nodes will speak to only cluster head. Okay, then that cluster head will communicate to next cluster head. So, in this way, the communication takes place. This is actually easy. Okay, you only can analyze what are the advantages and what are the disadvantages of the Leech protocol. And one more thing I want to tell is this is very important. Leech protocol is very important. Okay, so good thing if I if advantage if you ask me, advantage would be all the nodes are given certain time, so it knows only in that time it has to wake up. It has to transmit, that means it has to communicate, then it has to go to sleep mode. So not much of signaling later on is required, because once initially when it is given the signal, intimated that okay, your time slot is so and so, so and so, then it has no ambiguity that like whether the receiver is on, receiver is off, because it is communicating to the cluster head. Okay, directly nodes to nodes, there is no communication. Each node is communicating to cluster head. Okay, cluster head will see and it will direct it to the another node. So each node is becomes very accurate, very efficient, and the minimum energy power is also used. But that is very okay, good if you can maintain the synchronization, time synchronization. Where comes the problem? The problem is about the cluster head. Okay, who is cluster head? That is also a node. That is also a node. If you say that, okay, I want to have a exclusive type of cluster head for this, then that protocol is named as a mediation device protocol. We have studied that. Okay, in that type, we had given a exclusive device for doing this synchronization, all these activities only. They were not collecting any data. Okay, but whereas in this type, Leech type, we are not including such extra devices here in the network. Whatever devices are there, nodes are there, that only among them one we will make it as the cluster head. Okay, now the question is, then what about the cluster head? How long it has to be on? Yes, it has to be on throughout. Around the clock, it has to be on. Then what about the power? Yes, power it will drain out very soon. And I repeat, this is cluster head is also a node only. It also is a node only. Okay, then what is the problem? Okay, by if at all the cluster head is drained out, then all the nodes will go to off mode, because all the nodes are connected to cluster head only. If that only is not working, then what is the use of others being very efficient? So there comes the problem. Okay, so the solution for that is, okay, don't keep a node, dedicated node as a cluster head. Don't keep the dedicated node as a cluster head throughout the operation. Okay, maybe for for example, okay, time period when I take for one day, you keep the first node as the cluster head. Okay, next day you keep the node 2 as the cluster head. I have told you, okay, these are nodes only, so it is performing its basic function. Along with that, it is coordinating, it is controlling. So second day, second node will become the cluster head. Next day, next one will become the cluster head. So in this way, okay, in this way it is managed. Now what is happening? Yeah, day one, actually the node one used more energy, but day two, it is a just more node. In day two, it is just a node. So it can go to sleep mode whenever its turn doesn't come. So it is saving energy. Node 2 is actually exerting energy. So when, if I have suppose 8 nodes in that, in 8 days, all the 8 nodes would have become cluster head. So a same amount of energy would have exhausted. So if at all I have to supplement the power, then after 8 days, equal power can be, energy can be given to all the nodes. Okay, so this is actually balanced way. This is the balanced way. But now actually to tell, it looks, yeah, very easy. Okay, very direct. Fine, this looks quite very synchronized way. Okay, but the question is, okay, how actually it gets synchronized? Now I said, okay, node 1, node 2, node 3 will become the cluster head. In the actual scenario, it is not like that. Node 1 is placed somewhere, node 2 is placed somewhere. Okay, so there has to be a communication between the nodes. The next, who will be the cluster head? If, okay, first who will be the cluster head? Then after that, next who will be the cluster head? So like two nodes cannot act simultaneously as cluster head, cannot declare themselves as cluster head. Okay, it has to be one at a time, cluster heads. So that one synchronization should be looked into. Okay, so to all member nodes, TDMA slots are assigned, which can be used to exchange data between the member and the cluster head. With the exception of their time slots, the members can spend the time in the sleep state. So this is all we have learned. See this diagram, you'll come to know. See, these are the clusters actually. Okay, this is a cluster head, these are the nodes. Okay, here is the cluster head. Here is the cluster head, these are the nodes. Okay, check out here, the cluster heads, nodes are connected to the cluster head. Cluster head is communicating to the base station. Okay, so this base station again communicates to the next cluster head. From there, it goes to the next cluster nodes. So similar action is taking place for all the clusters. So in this, actually, node becomes very, very efficient, but the job of the cluster head becomes quite tedious. The cluster head aggregates the data of its members and transmits it to the sync node or to other nodes for further relaying. For cluster heads, it is energy consuming. Okay, always it should be on, as I have said. So role of the cluster head will rotate. Okay, other nodes join its network. So each cluster head picks a random CDMA code for its cluster and this actually, is it there anywhere? 1 second. Let me tell you, picks a random CDMA code. I will tell you why. We'll go to the previous diagram. Okay, if you see this diagram, suppose check out this node. Check this node, okay, which I am this thing now. See, it could have been the part of this cluster. It could have been the part of this cluster. Now it is a part of this cluster. Okay, this particular node. So just by doing the thing, so it may like it that such these things nodes which are in the border will have confusion, like we come under which node, which cluster. Okay, so in to overcome that confusion, and you know what, since this is in the very border to this cluster, the signals sent by this cluster head can be heard by this, can be heard by this also, because the range of this cluster is so much. The range of this cluster is so much. So this is very near to it. So naturally, this picks up this signal. This picks up this cluster signal also. Okay. And this picks up this cluster signal also. Okay. Huh? Now, how to overcome this problem? This problem, actually, if you see our mobile communication also, problems will be there. Now, how to overcome that? Okay, now each cluster head will select a CDMA code for its cluster. Okay, it will select a CDMA code for its cluster. So each CDMA code is different. Now it is hearing, this particular node is hearing or getting the CDMA code from here. What is this? CDMA code from here. Okay, it can hear CDMA code from here. It can hear CDMA code from here. Okay, this will analyze the signal strength of these three. So whichever signal has got, received signal has got higher signal strength, that it will adopt. That CDMA code it will adopt. So now this one is receiving this signal strength more. So it comes to, it adopts this one. So it becomes the part of this cluster. I don't think that anybody will go and they will draw a boundary over there. Okay, now all these nodes are in the remote place. Okay, so it has to, clusters and all have to be formed on its own. Cluster heads are responsible for forming the clusters. So in that case, nodes have to judge. Okay, we belong to which cluster? So how is it analyzing? It is analyzing in this way. It will check the received signals. Okay, it can receive many signals from different cluster head. Now it will check which has got more signal strength. So like us only, right? Even see, if we hear more than 2-3 voices, okay, for us, which is more clear, which is near to us is more clear, because the distance is less, and we tend to converse with that person and we ignore the other two because that was feeble compared to this one. And at a time we can speak to only one person. So same case applies here also. Okay, this belongs to this one. And later on, I don't know whether you have studied in the subject or no, in mobile communication what happens is, if this is a mobile node, okay, this node is a mobile phone. Okay, and that person is traveling. Okay, when he is traveling here, okay, when he reaches here, okay, that mobile gets a stronger signal from this one. Stronger signal from this one. Okay, because this distance is less compared to this one. So automatically it breaks up with this, it joins here. So this cluster head will come to know that, okay, one node has come to my area. So in that way, actually, a synchronization takes place, and that was about moving. Now here, actually, in this subject, when we speak, wireless sensor network, we are assuming, okay, by default, assuming that all the nodes are stationary, not the moving, moving one. Little bit of changes will be there in the protocols when we take moving nodes as well as the stationary nodes, and what protocol we discuss here is the stationary nodes. Where were we? The protocol is organized in rounds, and each round is subdivided into a setup phase and a steady state phase. Yeah, this is important. Okay. So now actually we'll discussing, we are discussing the point, how are we selecting the cluster head? Now in A1 batch, 8 are there. Okay, 8 people are there in the A1 batch. In that, today, person with roll number 5 is the cluster head. Okay, now tomorrow, who should be the cluster head? So that process we are discussing now. Okay. The setup phase starts with the self-election of nodes to cluster heads. So this is the first step, self-election of nodes. The nodes will declare themselves as cluster heads. Whoever, whichever nodes are interested, they will declare themselves as cluster heads. Okay, not over, the step by step I will tell. Okay, in the following advertisement phase, the cluster heads inform their neighborhood with an advertisement packet. Okay, so next step is it will advertise in the next time slot that okay, I have been declared as the cluster head. Okay, and that signal is sent to the neighboring nodes. The cluster heads contend for the medium using a CSMA protocol. So CSMA protocol is those codes are available. Okay, now it has to randomly pick the CSMA codes. The non-cluster head nodes pick the advertisement packet with the strongest received signal strength. This is what I was saying. Okay, now among the nodes, okay, suppose 5 is also this thing, 5 is also sending the signal, okay, and 7 is also sending the signal. Now 1, 2, all are they will stay back as nodes only, not the cluster heads. Now node 1 and 2 are getting the signals from node 5 and 7. Now they will check whose signal strength is strong. Okay, now see, this is the setup phase, advertisement phase, that is self-election of cluster heads. Okay, next cluster setup phase, members compete with CSMA, because CSMA is like randomly picked this thing, so it is picking up the CSMA code. Then broadcast schedule, cluster head broadcast CMA code to members. Okay, it is now 5 is also broadcasting, 7 is also broadcasting. The nodes which gets 5 stronger, the nodes which get 5 as a stronger signal will come under node 5's cluster. The nodes which get signal, node 7's signal as a strong one, they will go under node 7 cluster. So this is the okay, first you tell that okay, I'm contending for the cluster head, then pick up the CSMA code randomly, then send it to all the nodes. Whichever gets your signal as the strongest one, they come under your cluster. Whichever, okay, what is the now? Okay, you may wonder why she is telling that the strongest one, because strongest one is the nearest one to you. Whoever gets the strongest signal are the nodes which are nearest to you, so they have to come under your cluster only, though it is geographically divided. Okay, it is like the signal strength is inversely proportional to the distance. So if you get a stronger signal strength, it means that you are nearby. So you will come under that cluster head. So in that way, the next cluster head is being elected. Okay. And here actually, once, okay, you are elected and you know that which all nodes come under you, because they are the one who will give the reply that, okay, we are in this cluster, we are in cluster 5, because they received the strong signal from 5. Then you will get the count. Okay, you give the time slot for each node. You give the time slot for the each node. Okay, so under node 5, which became the cluster head, suppose now three nodes are there. Okay, then you give node 1 some time period, some time period, node 3 some time period. Okay, they will perform only during that time, and after that they will go to sleep mode. Till when? Until the next time slot. Until next time slot. Next, in the next time slot, again, whoever are interested should send the signal. Whoever are interested to become the cluster head should send the signal. Then only the node should become active and find out who is from whom we are getting the strong signal. Till then, it is free. In the following cluster setup phase, the members inform their cluster head, join, again using the CSMA protocol. After the cluster setup phase, the cluster head knows the number of members and their identifiers. This is what I said. Cluster head constructs a TDMA schedule, I said, picks a CDMA code randomly and broadcasts this information to the broadcast schedule subphase. After this, the TDMA steady state phase begins. The cluster head is switched on during the whole round. Member nodes have to be switched on only during the setup phase and occasionally in the steady state phase whenever their time slot comes. Okay, fine. That was about the leech. Okay, that is interesting one also, and it is important one also, leech one, a leech, because here they are trying to avoid any extra hardware which is being used in the network. At the same time, okay, the balancing between the energy consumption of the nodes also is taken care in that. So that is one kind of protocol. So the next one in that schedule based is the self-organizing medium access control for sensor networks. Okay, SMACs. It essentially combines neighborhood discovery and assignment of TDMA schedules to node. SMACs is based on the following assumption. Okay, now here also, see, again I repeat, you may wonder what assumptions. It is actual network. No, maybe actual network, but I tell you that these are the proposed protocols. Don't know whether they have used anywhere or no. Okay, I don't say that they have not used anywhere. They might have used. Whoever is designing the IoT, okay, as wireless sensor network, they can opt for any of, they have to opt, in a sense, they have to design. They have to design any type of protocol. Okay, your project also could be like, take 2-3 protocols, compare it and give the this thing. Okay, for this particular network, if I, yours, like wireless sensor network will be there, okay? If I use this protocol, this is the efficiency. If I use this protocol, this is the efficiency. That is also possible. So this is actually one, assumed one, okay? Assumed scenario. The available spectrum is subdivided into many channels, and each node can tune its transceiver to an arbitrary one. Alternatively, it assumed that many CDMA cores are available. See, this is also assumption. Many CDMA cores are available. Usually need not be. Some of the CDMA cores are used by some other nodes, are being used by some other nodes. That is also there. But here actually when we design, we'll assume that all the CDMA cores are available. Okay. Most of the nodes in the sensor network are stationary. Yeah, this is one more assumption. And such an assignment is valid for fairly long times. Okay, each node divides its time locally into fixed length super frames. The goal of SMAX is to detect neighboring nodes and to set up exclusive links or channels to these. See, here difference is we don't give the name as cluster. Okay, we don't give the name as cluster, but okay, it is again finding out the neighbors and getting connected to it. Finding out the neighbors and getting connected to it, because to send something, okay, to maybe to some other node, it is making use of these nodes only. So what it means is, actually me, okay, I am a node. Neighboring to me, node A, node B, and node C are there. Okay, so I will establish a connection with these three nodes always. Okay, always. If I am stationary, if I am moving, then the scenario changes. Okay, now I am having this thing link with the node A, node B, and node C. If at all I have to send something to node X, then I have to see to whom, if I send, if they will convey that, transmit that message to X. Okay, I'll get to, there are many algorithms to find out that also, which path we are going, minimum distance path, all those things are there. So I will come to know that if I give pass it to node C, because for me only three are available, node C, it can pass it on fast. So I will be passing it on to node C only, then it is not my job. Though actually my intention is to send it to node X, I am sending it to node C. It is node C's business now to see how it can make the data reach to node X. Maybe it is a single hop, or maybe it is again multi-hop. Node C is sending to node M, okay, node M is sending to node X, possible. Node C directly sending to node X, possible. It all depends on where the node X is located. Okay, but my job is only I'm connected to three, A, B, C, because that comes under my vicinity. So that is the scenario of the SMAX. Okay, now these now see, a link is directional. Huh? Here one, this thing is one link or one channel is unidirectional. Okay, only A can send, B can listen. Yeah, that's all. Okay, if at all yours is a bidirectional operation, then you have to go for two separate links. Okay, it's not required that a node and its neighbors transmit at entirely different times. Okay, now it is me, okay, node P I am, and I am connected to three nodes, node A, B, C. So we make an declared a small cluster, correct? No, in the previous one we said it is cluster. Now we are saying, I'm not telling it is a cluster, but a small group we are making. Okay, I want to send something now, is it that all the other three should be alert only to listen to me? No, not necessarily. Okay, only when the control signal goes to identify the node for my transmission, all should be alert. Later, once when I start transmitting to node C, A and B can transmit or receive on their own. Okay, I will not be affected by that. And one more option is, I am a node. Actually, I am transmitting to node C, but at the same time, node A wants to transmit to me. So that time I will become the receiver. Yes, I can do simultaneously. I can do transmitting as well as receiving simultaneously. Okay, no collision. Why? Because as I said, one channel is unidirectional. So one channel exclusively I am using for transmitting. So if A wants to send something to me, then it has to select a separate channel for me. So I am receiving using a different channel. So what is the problem? Where is the collision? Where is the overlapping? No overlapping. So I can manage simultaneously both transmitting as well as receiving. So this is what it means. Okay. And then in the case, however, they must transmit to different receiver to have use of different frequencies. Frequencies nothing but links. Okay, after the link setup, the nodes wake up periodically. That how it is defined in the beginning of the design of the network. in the respective receive time slots with the receiver tuned to the corresponding. Now see here, this is the different types, okay, this one. So here if you see, establishing connection, establishing, I have connection with node A, node B, node C. Now this is actually, this diagram tells you how actually any two node can have connection. Now nearby X and Y, two nodes are there, okay, how they can become their neighbors, how can they can declare themselves as neighbors. So there are four options are there, okay, four cases are there. This is type 1, this is type 2, this is type 3, and this is type 4. Okay, in type 1, okay, here in the type 1, the node X listens on a fixed frequency band for the random amount of time. If nothing is received during the time, then node X sends invitation message, okay, in this way, X unnet 0, okay, that is the invitation message it is sending to Y. Okay, unattached means it does not have any previous neighbors. So this is, okay, if any previous neighbors were there, then the format would have been different. Now previous are not there, so this is the format X. Okay, this is the address of this. This actually I don't have any previous connections, and sending to Y. Okay, indicating its own node identification and the number of attached neighbors, which is 0. As of now, nothing is there. Okay, when any neighbor Z of the node X receives this message, it waits for a random but bounded amount of time and answers with type 2. Okay, this is the type 2. Okay, that is X, Y unattached. And X receives this message properly. Okay, this is the second type of message sent by Z. Since Y send the first answer, okay, X invites Y to construct a link by sending the type 3. Okay, this is the next type of message sent by X. Now what am I saying? I am telling you how the connection between X and Y is getting established as neighbors. As neighbors, not to send any data. Data, whenever it comes only, we will be sending. Not all the time. But when we get the data, we need some procedure to connect. So this is the procedure to connect. Okay, so X is sending to Y, inviting, okay? Okay, carrying the identification of the winning node Y and no further parameters. Okay, here only Y is there. This message is sent when the contention period, okay, one second, okay, now once this X sends this type message here, Y gets to know that, okay, X is accepting me as a neighbor, okay, then it will select one TDMA slot, okay, one TDMA slot for the operation between X and Y. Okay, because Y got to know that I am X neighbor, I am the neighbor of X, okay. So in this way, now this is type 4 for the link specification. That is the link specification is nothing but the TDMA slot. Yeah, Y should tell no to X, okay, when it will be on. So when the TDMA slot is randomly picked by Y, okay, suppose it is like 10:50 to 11 o'clock. Then Y will send it to X. Y will send it to X saying that, okay, our time slot is 10:50 to 11. So I know that if at all I have to send anything to Y, Y being my neighbor, okay, I have to send it at on I mean in between 10:50 to 11 only. So time slot is given. Once that is over, that TDMA is again given back. It is not that every time 10:50 to 11, it is given back. So in this way, the connection establishment happens. Okay. This protocol, this is important actually. Okay. This protocol allows to set up static connection between stationary nodes. Okay, since the neighborhood discovery process is repeated from time to time, the protocol can adapt to changes in any topology. Okay, different mesh star, any topology you give, it can adopt it. Next, a crucial issue with this protocol is the choice of the super frame length. Okay, what is the time in the TDMA? What is the super frame length? Okay, it should be large enough to accommodate the highest node degree in the network. Okay, which is a random variable for random deployments. That means what? Okay, it should have more number of nodes. It should have more number of nodes in nodes as more number of neighbors to one node. One node should be connected to many more number of nodes, not just two, three and all. Okay, if the super frame length is too short, some of the nodes neighbors may simply not be visible to it. Okay, now a second problem occurs in a densely populated sensor network with low traffic load, where schedules are highly populated and nodes wake up quite often just to notice that there is no packet destined to them. So this is another problem. Okay, if the number of nodes are more. Okay, now the third one is a traffic adaptive medium access protocol. Okay, this is the third one. First we have learned about leech, second SMAX, and third one is TRAMA. It creates schedules allowing nodes to access a single channel in a collision-free manner. Okay, this is different now. It will access a single channel. The schedules are constructed in a distributed manner. The protocol assumes that all nodes are time synchronized. This is also assumption, as I said, because this is the proposed one. This protocol is the proposed one. It divides the cycle into random access period, scheduled access period. Okay, nodes broadcast their neighborhood information, like last protocol what we have said, also captures the respective packets from their neighbors. So a node can learn about their two hop neighborhood. On the basis of this information, the nodes execute a distributed scheduling algorithm to determine for each time slot of the scheduled access period. Okay, when to transmit, when to receive, and when to go for sleep mode. The protocol itself consists of three different components. Okay, neighborhood protocol, schedule exchange protocol, and adaptive election protocol. Okay, we need to identify some what is protocol. It is a set of rules to identify neighborhood. Who are my neighbors? One protocol is used. Okay, schedule exchange, one protocol is used. Adaptive election, one protocol is used. Okay, in the first one, neighborhood, it is executed solely in the random access phase. Okay, so a small time slots will be there. A node picks randomly a number of time slots and transmits small control packets. Okay, so it is a single node to single node, no cluster head business, all those things. So whoever wants to transmit, it picks randomly a small time slot, okay, and transmits a control packet. These packets indicate the node's identification and neighborhood information. Okay, so it is saying that this signal is sent by node X. Okay, node X. So this is the information sent. If a node does not transmit, it listens to pick up its neighbor's control packet. Okay, so X is sending, but now node A is simply, it is not sending anything. That means what? It is actually waiting for somebody to accept it as a neighbor. If the node is not sending, it is in the receiving mode. Okay. By the schedule exchange protocol, a node transmits its current transmission schedule, okay, indicating which time slot and all, and also picks up its neighbor's schedule. Now, actually, node X also would have got one time schedule, yeah, and that whatever control signal it has sent, that is received by node A. Node A also has got time schedule, so that is getting exchanged. That is getting exchanged because those two are neighbors now. When they are neighbors, okay, where X can utilize the time slot of A, A can utilize the time slot of X. I hope you got this point. Okay, this is different type. No cluster head. When the cluster head was there, it was allocating the time. So one node used to get only one time slot. Now, since these are selecting their own neighbors to transmit, they can each one is selecting its own time slot. So when they are exchanging the data, they can utilize two time slots. Okay, transmitter's time slot, receiver time slot. Time slot is dedicated for transmitting. The schedule are computed by a priority rules. Okay, the adaptive election algorithm provides approaches for resolving scheduling issue by allowing nodes to reuse their neighbors' unused slots. Okay, so in this algorithm, as we have discussed earlier, okay, how actually scheduling should be done, okay, who are their neighbors, okay, once it is neighbors, see, I have to send to node A. Node A is in the listen mode, but node A has one time slot, but it does not have to send anything, so that the time slot is free, right? I can take that, I can reuse that to use my work, to do my job. Okay, so that priority is also given. So this is the third type, trauma type of, it is the combination of first and second. Leech and SMAX are important. Okay, so here I will be finishing my class. Till here you have for your internals. Okay, now any doubt? Anybody, any doubt? Or same, should I call you Prima?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you understand or do you have any doubt?
No, ma'am.
No, okay. What about Savant? Savant? No, okay. You have understood? Savan, did you understand? Clear. Okay. In A section, who is there in A section? Adeline?
Yes. Yes, ma'am. Understood.
Is it clear? I am not asking it is should I repeat? It is just a story. Okay, it is different types of nodes, how they are getting connected. I am again and again repeating, it is just the proposed protocols. Many researchers have come up with one. That is why actually when you are coming up with the new protocols, some will start from the scratch. Okay, new one. So, now, trauma and all is that just a modification of the previous one. Okay, because those researchers would have taken the base as the leech. Yeah? Okay, on that only little bit of change they would have done, and they would have proved that this method is better. So that becomes another protocol. That's all. Okay, modification of the previous one. So these are the protocols. I don't think that it is hard to understand. When you are listening to me, if you have any doubt, okay, why like this, what is this, okay, see, like, since this is fully communication, some words you are not able to imagine only. That possibility is also there. Okay, what is she talking about and all. So in that case, you can ask that also. Absolutely no shame in that. Okay, because simply we are imagining here, okay, about the one wireless sensor network, okay, it could be like this and all. Two nodes communicating, all those things. So if you're having any doubt, why this, okay, you're free to ask such doubts also. That is why I'm randomly calling the name. Otherwise, topic-wise, even I know that it is not difficult. It shouldn't be difficult. Okay, Osmita. Osmita.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, do you have anything to clarify?
No, ma'am.
No? Everyone would have then?
No.
Okay, okay. Okay, I'll keep it open now. Does anyone else have? Until today, the portion is there, okay? Module 4 and Module 5. Wireless sensor network and these protocols. Okay. I'll just for 30 seconds. If anyone has any doubt or any discussion is required, then actually you can come up now. Anything? B section, anyone? Today Sagar is present. No. Okay, then I think if there is no discussing, all the best for your exams. And I see again, I repeat, I don't want, okay, this time the correction, I will make it stricter. I don't want you all to write a continuous paragraph. Okay, however, I have put in my PPT, point by point, you need to write. Okay, yes, it is not like how much ever I have put in PPT only. You need to go through the textbook. You need to go through the textbook, and in that you make points. Those points will be helpful for you for your final exam also. So now only make the notes and keep point wise, and those point wise only I want. Okay, I am not going to explain you why I have deducted mark later if you write in a paragraph wise. Many are there after, because not only in your class, this I've been telling for all the theory classes which I have held earlier also, and it is students' tendency to write in a just a paragraph wise. I don't know where their brains will be when they are writing. Okay, well, I am not asking something very very tedious which you don't know or which you can't do at that that time slot. I am just asking you, whatever you are writing the sentence, that make it in a point wise, so that it is easy for us to understand when you are reading. Okay, if you have written for 1.5 hours, you can't expect us to read for 1.5 hours. Okay, so we will be reading fast. So we will be searching for the keywords. So in that time, if you are writing, okay, and you can't blame me for that. If you are writing in a paragraph wise, and you, if you are expecting me to search words in that, I'm sorry. Okay, if you write in a point wise, then it is easy for me to search. So based on that points only, I will be giving the mark. So later I will not give an explanation for this. So you need to write in a point wise. Okay. So all the best students. So we'll meet after the internals. Okay.